Hey gang, Kevin here, Life22, and going through and reviewing the school board from October 19th, 2021. And we're filming here from my home state of Connecticut. So we'll be reviewing this tonight and hopefully have a few other things for you guys. And let's, dagnabbit. Must have shut it out. We'll get it here for you in a second. There we go. So this one's an easy one because literally they do a call of order, they do a silent prayer, moment of personal reflection, they do the Pledge of Allegiance, they approve the agenda, and then there's the public comment. And then with this one, literally they have zero sound up until 14 minutes. And so as we scroll through to about the 14 minute mark,
Thank you.
And just to clarify, if you could check out the minutes, there was a Wendy Filbert from the school library who spoke, and then 14 minutes and 10 seconds in, they get the sound back. 14 minutes and they get the sound back, and then they, the second speaker is Dan Gayton, and that's where we pick up.
Next up is Mr. Daniel Gayton.
How's everybody doing tonight? I want to, my name is Daniel Gayton, taxpayer in the city. Want to talk to you guys a little bit about Mr. Wichert. I appreciate the comment from the attorney, but that's just not good enough and flies in the face of everything that we're talking about. Here you guys.
So I believe what we missed during the silence was somebody reading a statement from their lawyer, we get into that a little bit.
I have a public school which is diverse, and this public school system was built for equality for everybody, and now all of a sudden we're starting to segregate people into whether they the haves and the have-nots. You have a principal at the intermediate school talking about if you get free lunch or you know, subsidized lunch, that all of a sudden it's a socialist program and their parents are lazy. Well, here you have one administrator that works for the school, went to the school, played football with a whole bunch of people who probably 80% of them kids on a football field got free or subsidized lunch. But it's okay to cheer for them on Friday, but it's not okay to hang out with them Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and all of a sudden they're socialist. You guys have somebody from the church here sitting on your board who gives out free shoes to the same person to the same people that these guys are talking about. But yeah.
So Dan's hung up yet again on the free lunch programs, and I think from Joel Witcher's videos that he literally was just stating that you should teach a man to fish, not give out fish, right? That's the point. And these places that you go for soup kitchens and stuff like that are really not helping. There's the same people every week. Those people are not learning to fend for themselves and get their own food. They also qualify for food stamps. And so they have the ability to go out and use that funding to get food and not have one of the major incentives to doing something is so that you don't starve to death. And it's one of those things. The incentive for having an apartment is so you don't freeze to death. And when you subsidize both of those things, you have no incentive to go do anything, really. And that was Joel Witcher's point, and it makes a lot of sense. But you get guys like Danny Gayton who don't think deeply enough into it and just says, it's not sensitive. Like, well, guess what? The world isn't sensitive. The world is a tough place, and no matter what humans do, you're not going to make it any less tough. There's still things out there eating other things, and we are the thing that eats other things right now. We go out there and we eat, you know, cows and plants and stuff like that. It's at some point in the past, we were also being eaten by other things, and we've done a good job being at the top of the food chain. But so anyways,
nobody says anything. It's all fine, it's all good. The attorney's had more than enough time to work on this case. All that is just kicking the can down the road and doing
nothing. It's not a case.
What are you guys gonna do when you guys can't follow your own policies like you do now, and all of a sudden these kids start to question whether or not they should follow the policies in the school, whether they should follow the code of conduct, whether they should follow all that stuff. And they bring it right here to the board, and all of a sudden it's an appeal. What are you guys gonna do when you tell them that they have to follow the same policy that your administrators don't have to follow? You can't be hypocrites and tell them that they have to. That's not fair to them. And then that leaves on the back of the teachers here in a school to deal with this chaos nonsense. And you can't even give them a contract. That's what your attorney needs to be speaking about. It's time for you guys to stand up. It's time for you guys to say something. Silence means that you agree with what's going on.
No,
there's
it does
no
not.
Other way around it. You can't hoopla and holler when everybody gives you.
No, it does not. Silence does not mean that you agree with what's going on. That's like assuming that silence also means you're guilty. And that's basic. That's basic, fundamental human rights, that you don't. Silence doesn't mean anything, really.
Something free out here in the community and they call a socialist program in school. That's just hypocrite. That's hypocritical. It doesn't make sense. He's broken every single policy that a teacher could break, but yet we're gonna sit here and kick this can down the road. Give the man an ultimatum. Retire by Friday or get fired by Friday. That's the only thing that works. Or these kids are gonna start, or they're gonna really start questioning why do they need to file the code of conduct? If he doesn't need to follow it, why do they? And I can't wait for a parent to be strong enough, couldn't be my kid, that broke the code of conduct. Because I'd be right here at the board saying, you can't do nothing to my kid. If he don't have to do it, they don't have to do it. And it's that simple. And it falls on the backs of them. And you can't even give them a contract. And they're the ones who are gonna have to deal with the outcome while you guys stand up here on your purchase and going, hey, we'll tell you what to do, but we ain't gonna pay you. You deal with them kids.
Thank you, Mr. Gayton. Mr. Martell. Mr. Katzenstein's trying to get into the meeting and he's having some trouble. Can you give him a... Can you check that out for me? Thank you. Our next speaker on the list is Mr. Gary Harvey.
Oh, this one will be fun.
Very simply, I would like to start by expressing my confusion with the attorney's statement. I fail to see how it's a personal matter and not a matter of public interest. So there's some confusion there. I think the necessity to foster a safe, welcoming, inclusive, diverse atmosphere in our school system has been long overlooked. We've placated, we've stuck with our traditional dogmatic thought processes and haven't created a safe environment for our young people. I would like to strongly encourage and urge this board to consider something to the effect of a equity and inclusion, a diversity committee made up by members of the faculty, members of the student body, as well as members of the community. In order to properly represent the individuals that you're serving, you have to take a piece of the pie from everybody, not just who thinks like you and agrees like you. But furthermore, I think that it's unacceptable at this time, and I had a lot of people tell me that I shouldn't say anything to this effect because I'm involved in city politics and the city stays out of the school and the school stays out of the city and there's like this hush hush. And we have our teachers who don't have a fair contract. We have our teachers who are a direct representation of how our city views its future. When someone moves to the city, if they have kids, one of the first things that they're gonna consider is, where are my kids going to school? What does that school look like? And we can't pay them, we can't treat them fairly, we don't give them what they deserve. Oh, hard work's gonna be rewarded when it's convenient. When I ask to be put, When I asked to be put on the agenda, I received a phone call that afternoon from Mr. Rick Moore, and I appreciated that phone call. He said, hey, somebody said you wanted to talk to me. I said, no, I just wanted to be put on the agenda, but since I have you on the phone. And we talked about the teacher's contract, and the response was, we're working really hard to make that happen. Now, I grew up in this area, but the people that I know that are from Missouri, they're gonna let you know, they're from the Show Me State. And lip service isn't enough if we're truly going to do what's in the best interest of our kids. And if we're going to do what's in the best interest of our kids, then we need to do what's in the best interest of our teachers. Teachers to give up their personal time, not just on the clock time, personal time, to make sure that the students have a lesson that's prepared and able to be articulated well enough to reach each student that's in that class, because not everybody learns the same way. You can't get a fish to climb a tree. They'll fail that test. So those teachers have to adapt and adjust. We need to pay them and adapt and adjust and give them what they're worth.
Thank you, Mr. Harvey.
So the next speaker is Ms. Jessica Malone.
Hello. If you didn't know, some of our students bravely spoke out about their experiences at the protest. I'm here again because you were not. You're not hearing their stories. You didn't even listen to their voices. District policy says when these situations arise, even off the school grounds, that the perpetrator is in violation of the code of conduct. It sounds a lot less complicated than people are making it out to be. He's an employee, one that should be held to a higher sense of accountability. And when employees violate policies regarding conduct, that can be reason for dismissal. Students have complained about being harassed by teachers. I have heard of teachers being intimidated by administrators. Where does it end?
So all hearsay, let's continue on with that. But also, just because the school district creates a policy that is overreaches and says, no, even if you're in the bedroom with your spouse, you must follow these codes of conduct or whatever like that. You shouldn't have the authority for this, and we've let it go on for too long, and that's why people are now under the assumption, well, it's been happening this way for 20 years. Well, I hear that same excuse from the other side of the aisle when they say, well, just because it's been happening for 20 years doesn't mean that you get to continue to do it. And that is where I draw the line and say, okay, then if that's the case, then the other case might be this. So, yeah, just because... Sorry, you'll notice me dip in and out. I'll pause the recording and run out, and I'm also helping out with baby duty. So, what's part of it? Getting this stuff done, getting to the valued fans. But it's very important that some of these policies are overreaching their bounds, and then you have to do this, and we can encompass it all the way up to this. Just because it's been happening for 20 years, just because people haven't spoke out like myself. And said, hey, you guys, this is ridiculous that you're allowed to come up with policies and change laws and make laws that are unconstitutional for so long and no one's ever challenged it or spoken up against it, does not mean that it's on the correct path and framework for our country. So let's let her continue.
No one is being heard. Instead, we're frustrated, some are fed up, and some see the retaliation that happens and decide not to speak up. The school and principal portrayed support for the protest, but one of the kids organizing it was taken out of class by the SRO in his uniform with his gun and escorted to speak with the school principal
Protest. I doubt it.
In my opinion, it was...
Was he carrying his gun on his person, which he's required to do as the SRO, as a police officer? Maybe that's what it was. What was he supposed to do? I'm going to get this particular kid out of class. I better leave my gun in my office or my car. Like, that doesn't sound smart when he's an officer and he's required to carry a firearm with him at all times, no matter where he's located.
Intimidate the student.
I doubt it.
The student from instruction and treated them as if they were in custody. Who decided the SRO was needed instead of the PA system? At the very least, it was an improper use of the SRO that left his other duties unattended. Further comments were made that providing food security to children in schools causes their parents and families not to work. How many children are not going to eat a school breakfast or lunch and tragically go hungry because they heard those comments? It raises other questions I have as a parent. Does he judge my child's discipline based on their Medicaid or SNAP eligibility? What factors decide healthy family support that diverts a child from PINs? Religion, income, gender identity? And these protections that we're asking for go for Christians as well as every other religion. There's a trend in this city. The more power you have, the less likely you are to be held accountable. Our kids learn this unspoken code here that bigger the title, the more you can get away with or their rules don't apply. Let me be clear, I'm here for the children's best interests. Our students' complaints are being ignored. They're losing their dignity. They're being treated like they don't matter. Excuse me. Like they don't have a voice. You, our elected officials, have the authority to act. The school district policies, including the code of conduct, holds everyone accountable, not just students. We want answers and we aren't getting them from the superintendent. We've only gotten non-answers and no real assurances that he even understands the problem. This is not about a person or a religion or a man's freedom. It's about what is best for our children. Dignity for all students, tolerance, respect. Those are more than words. It's the law. Your district anti-harassment policy references it. Are we to believe that this pastor who publicly rejects things not in the government of God will check his principal, his personal beliefs at the door, that this will, that he
Thank
will
you, Jessica.
His job,
uh-oh. His job don't interrupt her. She's going to piss off her
Let's
husband
move
again.
On to the next speaker,
I don't think
please.
So, and the students don't think so either.
Thank you.
Next on our list of speakers is Ty Malone.
Good evening. First, I would like to address that First Amendment freedom of speech stuff. If they have the freedom of speech, does that go for the principal being able to call my kids whatever they would like? Because if he says the wrong thing to my children, that attorney is going to need more than that little statement. Freedom of speech, that don't go for hate. Teaching our kids, telling them that they got problems because they have mental abilities and stuff. You guys need to address this. Now you guys already heard most of the concerns of the parents here tonight, so I'm not gonna go over them because I did have a lot that the same concerns as them. So I'm going to get to some other stuff because that stuff seems to be hard for you guys to be able to take care of. I would like you guys to address the process in which the community has to go through to speak at these meetings. There's no reason for us to have to register a week before speaking, nor explain what we want to speak about. Being that you guys were elected to the school board of all places, one would hope that you understand civics. To the person on the board that tried to disrespect my wife 2 weeks ago after I, who was the next speaker, gave her my time when she was exercising her right as a taxpayer and as a mother of students in the district, I hope you're happy. She is a lot more reserved than I. And because of time, here are a list of my concerns. You have a principal that's getting aggressive with teachers, even to the point of cornering the teacher because they would not bend to his will. And what does the board do? Not only show the abuser he can get away with it, has the teachers fighting for a contract that's way overdue. While the abuser enjoying his $139,000 salary, what kind of message does that send? Hard work will be rewarded? I don't think so. There's another principal who is out spewing hate in the community and has admittedly stated that him and others of his following have infiltrated our schools. I would like to take a second to recognize those kids that he was talking about. You know, the ones that eat free lunch or are Muslims or in the LGBTQ plus. Those are the same kids that put them trophies in your hallways and them banners in your gym. Respect them. Part of the board's job is to keep the teachers and the students safe. Yet you guys have done nothing. Maybe the SRO officer should be there for the principals instead of the kids. We want to see minority administration positions. We want to see minorities in staff, teachers. That means you have to look outside of Olean. We want guidance counselors that care about our kids, not just a select few.
10 seconds.
There is no way to justify the percentage of minority kids that go without scholarships or even introduced to the programs like ATOP. We want our kids taught real history, not his story. That means Africana studies curriculum.
Thank you, Mr. Malone.
American curriculum.
Let's give the next person a chance to speak.
We would like to see a diversity committee made of members of the community, teachers, students, and administration of the board.
Mr. Malone.
We want our teachers.
That's the end of your time, Mr. Malone.
That is long overdue. We want our board and our administrators to listen and work with us, or with the community and its teachers. Thank you.
Maybe next on the list,
maybe this should bring the SRO.
Marconi.
Maybe this should bring the SRO for Mr. Malone.
My name is Angie Marconi. I'm an Olean resident, an Olean taxpayer, and a graduate of Olean High School, classmate of Julio's, actually. I currently teach seventh grade math at Oames, and I'm the OTA vice president. This year is my 11th year teaching in the district. I love teaching in Olean, I love teaching math, and I love teaching 12 and 13 year old students. There is something special about teaching middle school. When students start seventh grade, most of them are shorter than me, or just tall as me. And by the time they leave, most of them are taller than me. It's awesome to watch them mature, learn, and grow into young teens right before my eyes. I have worked hard throughout my 11 years to create a standards-based curriculum. I utilize various resources to create my curriculum, but it is all teacher-created. I dig into state test data and modify my curriculum based on my students' performance. I spend time outside my contractual hours grading homework assignments. I even allow my students to revise their homework assignments so that they can learn from their mistakes and improve their grade, which makes more work for me because I have to grade things twice. I communicate regularly with families through email and Parent Square. I would not change a single thing I do because I feel that everything I do is in the best interest of my students. I am one of 200 plus teachers in the district who all go above and beyond for our students. We try to do all that we can to provide the best classrooms for the diverse population attending our schools. We all work hard. We all work outside our contractual hours. We all do extra things in our classrooms that create more work for ourselves. But we do all of this because we want to be the best teachers we can be for our students. We became teachers to make a difference in our students' lives so that they can become successful adults. Considering all that I described, it is disappointing that we stand here today entering our second school year working without a contract. Equally concerning, our neighboring districts, school districts that have recently settled contracts. We ask that the board value our hard work and dedication by making us a priority. It is imperative the board focuses on reaching a fair agreement with us. We look forward to continuing this process and coming to a speedy resolution. Thank you for your time and consideration.
So nothing she said was wrong. I just, I'd like to know some of the terms of the contract they're trying to resolve, which could lead us to some of the answers, right? That are, you know what I mean? That's where the discrepancies at. Why do the teachers not have a contract? These are the things we should be asking ourselves as taxpayers, as members involved in the community, right? Like, is it really just that, you know, that Rick Moore and the Board of Education are these terrible monsters that don't want the teachers to have a contract? Or are the teachers asking for too much? Or, I mean, I guess that's where the devil is in the details. What is too much? Is this not enough? Is this, you know what I mean? It's not like they're not being paid. And that's, you know, that's another, you know. So, like, I'd like to know what some of the fighting points are on the contract and what's holding up the contract from being passed. Those are things that I would like to know. Nobody has brought those to me. I'm not on the Board of Education, so I don't get to see some of those things. And then I would have a better understanding of what's going on. You know, so if you're with the school district or you're with the school board or you're with the Teachers Association, you know, reach out to the channel. We'd love to have you on and explain, you know, some of the stuff that the teachers want and see both sides of this story. So, when they applaud it.
Next on the list is Rachel Schreiber.
Rachel Schreiber.
So another Olean Teachers Association discussion.
I'd like to start by thanking the board for your graciousness
and allowing both Angie and me to speak tonight. We received your message earlier today asking one of us to forego our time tonight, so we would like to thank you for letting us keep our previously allotted times. For those of you in the audience who don't know me, I am Rachel Schreiber. I have taught second grade at Eastview for 21 years plus. I love my job because of my sweet students, their hardworking families, and my amazing colleagues. I am the current president of the OTA, and it is a complete pleasure to represent my colleagues because they are bar none the absolute best, most dedicated, most resilient, big-hearted teachers in this area. I stand here tonight representing 200 plus teachers and staff who have been working without a contract for over 400 days. During those 400 days, we have endured ever-changing working conditions due to the pandemic.
See, that's the thing I'd like to talk about too, is why, like,
as educators, we have never seen a landscape such as this. Not once did we shy away from the challenges of virtual learning, hybrid learning, altering our curriculum and lessons to address the needs of all students.
What's the point of calling it
supporting the needs of our diverse student population and their health and safety? Our students' welfare, education, and safety are and continue to be our number one priority. We show up for our classrooms and in our community. I have here.
Sorry about that, folks. Ma just got home with pizza and stuff for the kids, and so had to go grab a little dinner.
Hundreds of signatures from my members asking the district to respect and value us by negotiating a contract that is deserving of the valuable work we do. We are hopeful you will consider our request to put forth the time and effort it takes for the two parties to reach an agreement. We want a collaborative relationship with the district and its representatives that will help us reach our goal in having a fair contract as soon as possible. We are committed to this process and look forward to working together. If you have any questions about the hard work we do, I encourage you to come see us and talk to us in our buildings. We are proud of the work that we do every day. We are proud to serve the students of Olean. Thank you for your time.
Next up on our list of speakers is Timothy Sherlock.
Good evening, and thank you for letting me speak tonight. I hopefully won't take up too much of your time. This week, I did have a meeting with Mr. Wolf and Superintendent Moore, and it did go well. You know, I love the fact that we have open communication. But the problem we have here is our communication falls on deaf ears. I've been doing a lot of research lately, and I come to you usually very well informed because I get told often, I can't comment. I can't answer that. So let me remind the board, according to the National Board Association and the New York State Board Association, you are governed with three main responsibilities. One, to create, enforce, and correct policy. Two, to ensure contract and funding for the district, and to align the mission statement and the direction of the district where it's going. And when it is not going in that direction, you must correct it. We failed to do that terribly. We have a policy issue that came to light 3 years ago, not 3 months. In 3 years, you could not craft a policy? Again, I have no answer. So let me tell you this, I've run companies. Run million-dollar companies. If one of my employees set me up for a PR disaster like this, I would have gone to my board and said, give it to me by Friday. I have no time frames, no assurances. If you cannot hold your teachers and your district accountable, why did you run for this position? I'll make it very clear to you.
I'd like to know. I don't know that much about Tim Sherlock other than I mean, he lives in Olean, New York. He's an Olean, New York resident. I don't know why. He runs million-dollar companies. There's like $1 million company in Olean. I don't know if these are like stories that he's making up in his head or if he used to somewhere else run a million-dollar company, but I'm kind of at a loss for words if he thinks that that he's such a big heavy hitter and he's in lowly little Olean, New York. You know, oh, I run multi-billion-dollar companies. I'm Jeff Bezos. I'm this. I'm that. Like, okay, if you're just Bezos, Jeff Bezos doesn't live in Olean, New York. You move to like the big area where the big cities run. So, but anyways.
And to these teachers.
No, he's going to get a standing ovation.
Hold yourselves accountable.
I think he said he's running.
Thank you. Leo Walters DeHara.
Now for some intellectual speakers, right? By the way, before we let Leo speak, I just also wanted to let you know there's a great sale going down at Uncle Tony's. So if you've watched this far in the video, Uncle Tony's got these Bud Light Seltzer Lemonade Packs. And they are a great buy at $5.99 a 12 pack. Get down there while supplies last. They aren't the best seltzers in the world, but clearly by their price. So yep, Uncle Tony. Thanks again, Uncle Tony. Let the nonsense begin.
Hello. My name's Leo Walters DeHara. I'm a taxpayer, I'm a small business owner, and contrary to our first person who didn't have the courtesy to stay, I am in fact a Christian and a proud parent of a non-traditional family of students that go to Olean High School. We are not here to serve the best interest of those who already have their needs met. We are not here to stroke the egos of the privileged. We're here to make sure that everybody is treated with equity. On the Olean City School District.
To clarify, equity means that we all end up at the same place. That is the current motive, right? It's not we all have the same jumping off point. No, we all end up at the same place. We strive to make sure that every student who goes to our school district ends up at the same place. So they're all either the poorest of the poor or the richest of the rich running multi-million dollar companies. That's what equity means. It doesn't mean like we're going to strive for fairness, because not everything in life is fair. Life isn't fair, right? My parents raised me on that mantra, and it's true. I listened to Candace Owens had Ming Park. I might be mispronouncing her name, but I also shared she was on Dennis Prager like a month ago. A great story of an individual who grew up in South Korea, and she's like, man, I came to America and I love the fact that there's inequality, because there is no inequality in South Korea. It is, we are all dirty poor. That's it. We're all dirty and we're all poor and we can't afford anything. And so you can either be, she's like, within inequity, that means that you don't have to be just dirty poor. Like, that was what she was describing, and I think that when you start pushing equity, and everyone ends up in the same place, I have a feeling that what ends up happening is you all end up getting you most people. It's less likely that you're gonna have everybody be a bazillionaire, and more likely that everybody will be dirty poor, and nowhere in the middle. So.
Website, the guiding district of the principles are stated as a commitment to fostering a respectful, safe, and welcoming environment, embracing diversity, continuous improvement, academic excellence, and lifelong learning. Furthermore, we're committed to honesty, integrity, responsibility, and accountability. I've seen none of that from the school board. I've seen none of that from the administration. Andrew Kaya, I saw a complete lack of disrespect for the speakers last week from you, and from you as well, Mr. Padlo. It's unacceptable. You absolutely snubbed the speakers. You didn't care that they were speaking, and you spoke over them. How are we supposed to trust that you are going to have any, we don't have any faith that you're going to do something for our students? I've taken a couple calls in the past weeks from Aaron Wolf and from Mr. Moore, and I'm happy to say that they think of me as someone who should be called, but I will be taking no more calls privately. We will be communicating publicly from now on because this is a public issue and I don't want my ego stroke. I want change to happen. The way that you stand up is you make a stance like the Olean Teachers Association did in a full page ad in the newspaper. They stand for our students and you won't pay them.
They are getting paid. Let's clarify that.
They stand for our students and you won't let them speak at the meetings. Furthermore, it is not a personnel matter to address speech that is counterintuitive to the guiding principles of our school district. When hate speech comes up, you do this. This is how you ally. You say, we don't stand for hate speech. We don't stand for division, and we don't stand for the diminishing of human life of our students. The Olean teachers can get it right and you won't pay them. You don't have to make any grandiose effort, just simply say that was hurtful and wrong, and we can't even get an admission of that from you guys. That's unacceptable. The Olean City School District and the Olean City School Board has failed. Social scientist and attorney Joe Freeman wrote in 1973 that if institutions continue to keep power as diffuse as possible because it cannot demand responsibility from those who have it, it ensures that the organization will be as ineffective as possible. We've diffused the responsibility from the administrator in question. We've diffused the responsibility by, instead of making a public statement, making backdoor calls. It's time for the responsibility to be owned. And right now, you're saying a whole lot with your silence. Support our students, protect our students, and respect our teachers.
So that's it for the public comment. As you can see, just more people corking the bat. And then,
thank you everyone for your thoughts and comments. We're now going to move on to the next portion of our agenda.
So they get into communications. They talk about their regular meetings, their commendations. Let's see here. Then at 41 minutes and 15 seconds in, they get approval of consent agenda, which essentially looks like it's approving the finances and bills and giving Rick more consent to pay them. And then they go over the board meeting minutes, the treasurer's report, the warrant report, external claims and auditor's exceptions. There's a lot of stuff to this. It's all under the consent agenda, huh? So, intra fund transfer report, CPSE recommendations. Then there's PDF file attachments to this, the CSE recommendations, the substitute list, surplus items. 41 minutes and 15 seconds. And they cover all of that in 15 seconds because at 41 minutes and 30 seconds, they get to their committee reports. That's interesting. Our technology from the committee of October 7th, operations October 13th. And then at 45 minutes in, superintendent's report, which there's none.
In the previous plan.
And now on to the superintendent's report.
Yep, thank you very much. Just real quick, we wanted to stress that last week we had a professional development session, and Jen Kless is just going to report on that real quick to us.
So they had a special.
Yeah, Dr. Hunter return.
Nothing really. I listened to this whole meeting. There's nothing really here. At 53 minutes in, they do new business, and then.
Thank you.
And we're also tied under legal requirements to what we could say about this negotiations, but we will continue to work very, very hard with the OTA. And I just want to thank the board. It's a very difficult job. They're very good people. They work very hard. And I just want to thank them. And I know that this has been a very, as if you read the newspapers and you watch the news, being on a board of education wherever you are is not a very easy thing at this point in time. But I just want to tell you, I have full confidence, and I've never met people with
And in about 15 seconds, so we're going to have a jump in.
Honesty, and they will get the job done. And sometimes it takes longer, but they will do that. So thank you very much. You didn't need to speak out right now, sir. You had your chance to speak. Thank you.
We're going to move on to new business if you're done with your report, Mr. Moore.
So, yep, new business starts, and Ty jumped in. 54 minutes, Ty jumps in, and then Rick Moore yells at him, and they talk about, you know, working on the contract, and they go into new business immediately after. And as you notice right here at 54 minutes or so, just before, all these people start leaving the room, right? They're all just like, screw this, we're out of here.
Next and is the Cattaraugus County High School Equivalency Instruction Services Math Reading Tutorial Services contract.
So they start talking about the Cattaraugus County High School Equivalency Instruction Service Math Reading Tutorial Service contract, and then they move into 54 minutes and 45 seconds, the Cattaraugus County After School Program for At-Risk Youth, the OESPA MOA, 55 minutes and 15 seconds, 55 minutes and 40 seconds, the donation to Walsh, 56 minutes and 15 seconds, Futures Education. Then they skipped over a teacher's aid appointment. They moved it somewhere later. They created a cleaner's position at 56.50. For 47.40, they created a maintenance worker position. 59.05, the professional development plan. They discussed that. There's some real meat coming up, and it's towards the end. Because most of this stuff is just kind of like, you know, bullshit housekeeping stuff. They 59 minutes and 45 seconds, they go through the calendar amendment. Then 1 hour into the meeting on the dot is where the juice starts. And they go for 16 minutes to talk about this. And I mentioned this in the last meeting. I mentioned this in the last meeting that the juice was a-flowing.
Thank you, Julio.
This is the YMCA MOU.
This was also discussed in operations. It's just a minor tweak. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Abstentions? Now on to the YMCA MOU. We need to extend that or decide what to do with it.
I will motion to extend it to January 15th. I'll explain why in my discussion.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Do I have a second on that? Ty, thank you.
Reasoning behind is we had the holidays coming up. We kind of lost a little bit of mojo from the last time because we lost track of it. And this way it allows for the holidays to continue on, and perhaps we can have a demonstration as to what the YMCA can do. And then I figure with the January 15th end date, which is a Saturday, we will at least have one meeting in January by that time, because we got the 4th and 11th, I believe. And at least that way, we might be able to get some input from the Y.
We met with Barb, and I've talked with her a couple of times. They're hoping to get this done as quick as possible.
So the MOU is a... It seems like they're. I'm not sure the exact definition of MOU as an abbreviation. It's an anagram for something. I just don't know what it is. But from what I can tell, it is a contract that the school district has with the YMCA for childcare. It went through remote learning and things like that. They're applying for a grant, and it just seems very dicey. And you bring up, you'll hear here in a minute, Board Member Janine, I think is what her name is, will bring it up, and backed by Kelly Andrea, or Kelly Keller, and they'll talk about what this... they'll talk about what this is, like how it doesn't just apply to lower income students. It's essentially our school district is paying for the YMCA to watch people's kids, and they're not even at the full capacity.
They're still waiting from the state.
So I wonder, and if you listen to, I would like to point out, if you listen to Rick Moore speak here, because he talks to Barb Schweitzer, who is the I think she's the regional Y manager. She used to be at one point, so she used to like manage all the local Ys like between here and Bradford. I think she started out as Bradford. She's from Olean, but it was, or no, she lives in Bradford. I know her kids went to Olean. I graduated with a few of them.
Jenny and I have a meeting with her too, though, and Jenny's done a great job of adjusting the budget to make sure that you know, we're not overpaying, because originally there were supposed to be busing and other things in it. So we hear your plea that, you know, we want to watch this, the funding of this and how we're doing it. And then we're going to have a meeting this week with Barb, Jenny and I. So I appreciate your patience. I know that this is a tough one, but it's really good for our families.
Well, I'd like to see something on paper too by them, and like a proposal of what
right.
they plan on doing, rather than getting back to you too. But that's all right.
Yeah. I mean, I just, you know my feelings on this. I just, every other place in the country, I mean, I'm not saying don't have an after school. I'm saying it should be user fees. That is fundamentally, the parents should be responsible for this. And every month that we keep paying $9,000 a week, 40% of which is administrative overhead. We pay for 2.5 full-time positions at the Y to support a program that runs only during the school year for 3.5 hours a day. That's, I mean, it's just an absurd amount of money that we're paying. If we did it properly, that is, if we created an RFP and bid it out for anybody to bid on, for Montessori to bid on, we wouldn't be paying $9,000 a week. We would get other programs that underbid that, because it's a really high price for what we're getting. Mm-hmm. And we're not even cost sharing with parents. We're making it free for parents, many of whom receive childcare subsidies from other sources. So we've started doing this on a quote unquote emergency basis because the Y can get its funding, and we just keep doing it month after month. So I think the way to handle this, we set an end date, we write to parents, and we say, and the Y, that this is the Y's program. Our funding hasn't come. If you want to continue to have your kids get after school programming, you have to pay for it until our funding comes. That's not a ridiculous proposition. And think of all the other needs that we have right now. We're not even addressing the kind of learning loss issues that happened last year. We haven't even started any of our own after school programs. We haven't even investigated them. I mean, I know the elephant in the room is the contract, but we got to deal with that. Remember, we've got to start we're running out of time. 2 years, it's a small window. Unless we get stuff going, we're not going to address the learning loss issues that our kids face that year. We owe it to our kids not to take the easiest route, to say the Y's got a program in place, let's just write it to them. We owe it to our kids to say, how are we going to use this stimulus money to meet the needs of the students who have just had a very tough last 18 months. And, you know, I just don't like taking the easy way out. So why can run a program, finding funding sources other than the school, and the school should use its money for our needs and the programs that are going to address the problems of the roads and the last 18 months.
So how many kids
So that's Mary Sheena following Janine. I believe it's Janine. I'm not on the board, so I don't know the names like that. But she brings up a very valuable point. Let's vet this out. Let's see what's going on. Why are we subsidizing all parents and things like that? Even the ones that get government subsidies for what they're doing, it's kind of ridiculous that these that our taxpayer dollars for the school district are paying for something that's we're already being taxed for, that are subsidized under our county taxes and our federal and state income taxes. So what is going on? She brings up a good point. Now, Mary Flipsheen is about to say something here, and let's go into that. And then, as you could see, Ira was raising his hand. He's got something to say, which should be interesting.
Did we say we're taking advantage of this now?
If I can.
Right around 200.
What was it? Yeah, Ira wants to jump in.
Go ahead, Ira. Ginny and I appreciate hearing again what was said at operations and the concerns. I know we agreed that the existing agreement goes for a period, and it ends abruptly, unfortunately, the 20th of this month. Yes, there was not a plan, but this is about kids. This is not about bidding. This is about children and families and good programming. And we cannot pull the plug in this smoke and mirrors, in my view, about the cost. Yes, we can devise plans, and I'm disappointed we don't have those plans. And I'm not sure January 15th is a good end date. And I certainly would want to see something that says in a motion, not later than whatever the agreed upon date is. But January 15th, in terms of children and families, means the program might start again at our expense after the holiday season, which doesn't make much sense. It would.
So what the fuck does he mean by children's and families? Every time I hear, politicians, right? He ran for elected office, which is the school board. So there's a lot of politics in this, and people don't seem to get it. It's separate from politics. No, this is politics. This isn't about money. This is about children and families. Like, what kind of bullshit is that? That's like, it's not about your rights. It's about safety. Right? And then they take away your rights. Well, you don't need rights because safety is more important. No. People who give up their rights for safety deserve neither. And that's what ends up happening. Oh, children and families. This isn't about money. This is about children and families. No, like, explain. Explain how. Don't just name a category. This is about children and families. Well, how is it about children and families? Oh, because the children use the after-school program? Like, I think it's ridiculous, the argument he's making.
Need to be most logically ended when recess begins. And that's all I can say. I certainly support the program. It's needed. And we're unfortunately in this pickle with New York State and contracting, which is a whole other conversation that took place. Thank you very much.
Just to bring up to date too, though, just so you know that Barb, I have asked Barb and talked with Dream It, Do It, and she's going to work with Dream It, Do It, and also the Boy Scouts. We have had that program in the past, so through Bonas. So they are working together, which is good, and Barb has reached out to them. But I know we're just in a inconvenient mess here, I guess, more than anything. But the good news is that we are servicing children, but it is, I can't disagree with Janine at all. It is a lot of money. Yes, it is.
It's a lot of money.
Ms. Mary Flipsheena. Mary Sheena.
I'm trying to think, how many more kids can we reach than 200 kids? And what more can we be doing for those kids? It's just a lot of money for after school.
So I wonder what Rick Moore's play in this, because he's really defending it. And Ira, I don't know what his play is either. I mean, there's a lot of defense here with no argument, and it's just a lot of resistance. And you'll see Rick here come up with a lot more resistance than you would expect out of a person. Like, was he sleeping with the why? I mean, it's very like thought-provoking what's going on here. Like, why are they defending this money, this income stream to the YMCA that isn't providing, you know, the proper, like, they're providing them with $8,000 a week, $9,000 a week, and it's 40% of it's going to admin. you know, and not all the students are utilizing it. It's being underutilized. So why would we continue to pay for something like this that also is financially bunk? You know, it's not being subsidized in the right way. We're subsidizing where there's already subsidies there. We're subsidizing people who don't need certain subsidies. It's a lot of nonsense and bananas. And you wonder, I smell some form of corruption afoot. I'm trying to figure out where it's coming from. I've spoken to students and teachers in the district, and they all, like the teachers specifically, said, if you had $9,000 a week, you know how much overtime you could give to teachers to actually, like, tutor students after school? You could handle damn near a district with that money. And the after school program would be run in-house through the school district, giving teachers pay for additional time there. But they don't want to do that. They don't want to go through that rigmarole. They want to somehow funnel money to the YMCA. What is the YMCA doing for these gentlemen? That's what I'm wondering.
And one of the issues is we just can't, like every other business around the country right now, is finding the help. It's really, really difficult to find people that were willing to do that work. So
I would like to say that at any time that we go after a grant, we don't create the grant. That's our job. It's the state legislators, senators and assemblymen that go create this. So our hands are kind of tied, and unfortunately, when you go after a grant, there's this thing called unintended consequences, and a lot of times we have to front money up and wait, and that's part of the business that we're in.
But Jim, we're not the people who went out for this grant.
Kelly Keller?
The why went out for this grant.
Well, I'm just saying, I'm just generalizing.
They should be fronting the money, not us.
We didn't go out to the
community saying this would be a free program. The Y did.
This is a stop.
And then they put it back on us to pay for it.
Right. It's not like we're putting it out there, and then when they get the grant, we're going to get reimbursed for that. We're just paying the money.
Right.
But the good news is this: we will have that for 5 years out. So, I mean, I guess it's kind of an investment if you look at it that way.
I know it's
painful for us all, but it is doing.
How is this an investment, Rick?
And we'll continue to monitor. And like I said, we're speaking with Barb.
We need to know how good it is for the kids. Like you're saying that. We've heard it all out here today.
Yeah.
My kids go to the program and they don't do their homework after school.
Well, I mean, if we have 200 kids in there, I think that speaks something.
So, yeah. Okay. There's 200 kids in there. And then like Kelly just said, her kids aren't. There's nobody there telling the kids they're supposed to do their homework after school. It's supposed to be an after school program. They're supposed to be watching the kids and making sure they do their homework and additional schoolwork
to the program. I don't think parents would put children in programs that.
Well, if it's free and you need to put your kids somewhere, you probably would.
So isn't that great that we're providing that?
I know, but
what a bullshit statement.
I know it's expensive, but I think it. I agree with Iris. We want it to end. We want to get the grant money as soon as possible, but.
I know it's just another thing though that just.
Yeah,
is hanging out there.
It is.
Like we're tired of hanging out there. That's the problem.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
don't condescend her.
Are we firm on this date?
No. So we
would have returned to normal.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
so Jim, can we amend that to say, no later than?
Sure. And that would be very helpful to us.
That way, as soon as it comes in, we can get rolling on somebody else.
That's fine.
Paying the money.
It also gives parents time if we need to let them know that, like at this date, they'll have time to make adjustments.
That builds in a cushion too, and there's no reason not to have.
So we're just gonna continue to pay for this bullshit. What? Who's getting their dick sucked here? This is what I'm worried about.
Well, they need to get motivated.
We've been funding this now. This is the second, the third month that this has come up. And there is no end in sight. And a little simple math tells us that it's going to cost us, if we were to fund it through the end of the year, it's $360,000. If we fund it through January, it's $180,000. I have an awful lot of trouble continuing to fund this program, considering the other needs and issues that we face right now. I don't like the the ending date in January. I would prefer to have it month by month. And then I thought we had discussed getting a report from the Y on exactly what is going on with this program, and I haven't heard anything.
Paul, we discussed at the last operations meeting getting an update, and then we also asked if we could be provided with a couple different options of what it would cost if we were to partially pay for it and ask for parents to pay part, what the cost would be if the parents had to pay all of it. We've asked and we haven't received anything yet. I mean, I realize we just had our operations meeting, but I mean, I haven't seen anything yet. And I, as far as I know, it's not coming. I mean, but it has been asked for. So I don't feel comfortable continuing.
Good point. No, these are very valid points. And, you know, kudos to Kelly Keller. I know the Kellers very well. They're very, like, stand-up members of our community, and they ask the tough questions, which apparently people are trying to back-roll them here and back-roll Janine and Mary, Sheena, Hirsch, and all these other people and try to fight against this.
I mean, this certainly not till January 15th. I mean, we've asked for options, and we haven't seen anything.
Oh, but hold on.
I mean, what is the administrator over there doing that we're paying for?
Ending it now if we want, but I don't think we want the repercussions.
Repercussions? What repercussions?
The kids come first.
You know, we thought that COVID would be over by now, too. I mean,
COVID is over. Shit.
These things are difficult.
It's a different subject, Rick. It's totally different.
Yeah, okay.
If somebody's running a business,
so do you want us to, we can end it now.
I want something in writing. What is it going to cost to keep running this? We've asked for it.
I wish I could tell you. Where is it? I'm not up in Albany. I can't tell you when the grant will be arrived.
You're not up in Albany, but the Y is down the street. Barb can certainly ask one of her employees to write up a list of what three options are of how else they can pay for this other than us continuing to pay for
Correct.
It.
Correct.
And if she can't, then we shouldn't.
Well, but I'm not up in Albany. Watch, she'll say that again like eight more
times.
Well,
that's why we have an end date of January 15th.
I would prefer to.
I don't want to screw with the holidays.
I'd make the call myself. But I'm not allowed
the holidays. Screw your holidays. This is why our tax dollars, our school budget is like $41 million. Our city itself runs on like $19 million. You know what I mean? $19 million. They handle your police, your fire, your roads. And, man, I mean, they're dealing, they manage your water and sewer, and that obviously is a separate bill in and of itself, but they manage all these other facilities, and they provide you so much for $19 million. You double that, more than double that bill, and you have a group of people that are educating our children and with an extremely high dropout rate, and the literacy rate, I mean, amongst kids between grades and things like that. I know that there's teachers that are trying their hardest, but a lot of times it's like an uphill battle. It's like being in the Civil War sometimes. You're stuck in a foxhole. You don't know when people are coming. You double that budget, and you pay for bureaucracy and bullshit and other little programs that seem like added benefits for an extremely high cost. And that explains why you get 15 times more for the city of Olean in terms of what you're provided to live your life than you are from the school district, where the school should be that should be a part of the city budget. You know what I mean? In terms of like, yeah, are streets important? Yeah. Is water important? Yeah. Is sewer important? Yeah. Are the police and fire department important? Of course. Are the elected officials and the code enforcement and all those other people important? Of course. Is education for your students important? Of course it is. The problem is that the education of the students with very minimal results is just an astronomical bill. This is why government should not be involved in a lot of aspects. It's crap like this. Let's just continue.
I don't really want to push it up to January.
Right. Let's stay until the next
one. It's not that far away.
We're saying if it, you know.
Well, we've got a board meeting on the 9th.
January?
Okay.
Make it the 10th then.
Julio?
Can I say something? I think a lot of people are uncomfortable with this, and I think pushing it one more month gives them enough time. I mean, it's been 3 months. They should have enough data to at least give us something, and then we should go from there. I mean, a month is better than January 15th. And I think if we did that, all of us could agree with that. And we definitely got to see something, though. Like, this is what I think the public is talking about as far as us just kicking the can down the road. We need to see something. You need to demand it or say, hey, look, either we see something or your funding's going to get cut off, period. That's
boom.
It.
See, I like this. But now watch. They use his speech and they derail it.
I mean, this isn't something we just started talking about. We've been talking about it. So I just can't understand why we're still August. Here talking about it.
Okay. So, Jim, how do you feel about changing the date to November 12th, which is a Friday, I believe? 13th. Let's call it the
13th. Okay. I'll amend that to the 13th.
Okay.
November 13th?
I thought they could.
Yep. And, Mr. Moore, please tell the YMCA to get show some motivation here, like now.
Right.
Okay.
So, I mean, I cannot control.
If they so choose the not to be motivated, then.
I'd like to tell you I could.
Okay, but again, we're not talking about the state. Like Kelly said, we're talking about what can the Y do to help.
Oh, I'm not in Albany.
And that's why Jenny and I are meeting with Barb this week. So, okay, and we can have Barb come.
That would have been cool.
Yeah.
I'd like to hear from her. All
right.
Really would.
Yeah.
We like to hear something.
Nothing.
On paper, too.
Right. This is what I'm talking about.
On the floor, amended to November 15th. Ty had the second. We're good with that. Okay. I'm going to call the vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? All right. We're going to move on. Okay, on to personnel. I'm trying to say that right. We have a cleaner resignation.
So they have a cleaner resign at 1 hour, 16 minutes, and 20 seconds in. Art department chair appointment, 1 hour, 16 minutes, and 30 seconds in. We're just going to go through fast track. The person they skipped earlier creating that that position, 1 hour and 17 minutes in. 1 hour, 17 minutes, 45 seconds in. Teacher's aide appointment, 1 hour, 18 minutes, 15 seconds in. Keyboard specialist appointment, 1 hour, 18 minutes, 45 seconds. Interim assistant principal appointment, and they discuss, this is the whole Chuck Bauer thing, and I really like Chuck Bauer. Then they have an approved list, and there's a whole like series of issues, and I talked to some people with the school district, teachers and employee and staff, to find out what's going on with this. And apparently they had somebody on the list, and the person on the list couldn't continue out their term, and they had left, and then they had somebody else, and then they left, and I guess, you know, Rick Moore just kind of presented Chuck Bauer, which Chuck's a great guy, so I don't know why he wouldn't have been on a list, and they tabled it for executive session. And then they go into a discussion item, part 8 of their agenda, at 1 hour, 20 minutes, and 45 seconds in. And this is very kind of more juicy stuff that we've discussed in the past.
He's Hun.
So moved.
Executive session.
Yes, so they move that to executive session.
All right, so we'll move on to discussion items for now. We're going to have our first reading of the revised public expression policy.
So the revised public expression.
Anybody have a copy of that?
So Kelly Keller reads it.
Does anybody?
Kelly Keller reads it here, and essentially, I should almost like
want to
give
read.
Her justice on
it was
this.
Attached
it's in your
to
packet.
The agenda.
Yeah.
I have it.
You have it?
I have it on my phone.
Okay. Do you want to go ahead and read it?
And
thank you.
I'm going to start by saying, because she'll bring up something here shortly.
Right.
And I want to ask what was removed from this.
So it
policy.
Will read, all meetings of the board shall be conducted in public and the public has the right to attend all such meetings. Public expression at meetings shall be encouraged and a specific portion of the agenda shall provide for this privilege of the floor. Am I reading and saying what has been taken out of this also?
No, just read as it reads. The new one as it reads.
Right.
This policy is not intended to violate public expression, but to ensure that the board meets its need to conduct its business efficiently and effectively. Contact the district clerk no later than noon on Wednesday prior to each meeting to request to speak during the public comment portion. Upon receiving the request, the superintendent, board president, and vice president shall determine the merit of the item and topic as it pertains to the work of the board. The president, at his or her discretion, or I'm sorry, at their discretion, can forego this requirement if deemed necessary prior to a board meeting. Before the public is invited to speak, the board president shall read a statement that defines what is appropriate for public comment and the time constraints. The statement shall include but not be limited to the following items that are not permitted. One, the use of an individual staff member's name. Two, comments that involve personalities. Three, the performance or conduct of an individual staff member. Four, specific and or confidential student-related issues. Board members may not respond or engage in debate regarding a public comment.
I love how they put that in there, that you're not allowed to respond. The Common Council doesn't do it as a form of practice, but it's not mandated. You can respond if you want to. I always highly recommend against not engaging, as you've seen in past videos on this channel. Aldermen and school board members I don't know why they haven't engaged, but common council members engage quite often, as they shouldn't, because all it does is becomes a back and forth debate. And now where's the person's time allotment run out? The common council also gives you 5 minutes. These people give you 3, and they're just kind of restricting it. Now, it's not your freedom of speech is given so that you can write letters to the newspaper, you can write letters, you can write editorials, you can post your own newspaper, you can speak publicly in a public forum, you can go wherever you'd like to speak your freedom of speech, and you can also invoke your freedom of speech at the polls by electing these officials. You're not entitled to give them your public comment at one of their meetings. I mean, I'm like the last person you'd expect to say that, but there is no right for you to do that. Now, once they let you into the room, freedom of speech, you know what I mean? But obviously at the same time, freedom of speech still exists, but you have the right. They have to conduct business and do and keep proper quorum with their meetings and all, follow their rules and regulations, and that becomes a big deal. And so by giving you the opportunity to do this, this is more of a... this is more of something that is just like to the pleasure of the public, not a right the public has to speak at their specific meetings. So just to clarify, Kelly goes on here, once she finishes reading this, she also mentions that she brought this up because she wanted to give people more freedom of speech type rights at these things. And what ended up happening was, and they ended up getting backpedaled to actually rescinding a lot of what they allow the public to say and stuff like that. And then you have Yahoo's, like all these crazies that are trying to make our school district change the way that they're doing things for their woke agendas. And guess what? Oh, the school district curtailed the shit out of their public comment section, or as they call it, the public expression portion.
Questions requiring further board action will be referred to the superintendent, board president, and or board committee. Public participation shall be limited in time to a total of 15 minutes unless the board, by a majority vote of its members, permits participation to continue for not more than one additional 15-minute period.
So a maximum of 30 minutes.
That's once recognized by the chairman of the meeting, no individual shall address the board for longer than 3 minutes. Complaints regarding any facet of the school operation often can be handled more satisfactorily by the administrative officer in charge of the unit closest to the source of that complaint. Complaints should initially be referred to the building principal and their assistant if the matter cannot be resolved by the teacher, coach, or other school employee. Please refer to policy number 3230. That's all.
So I think it's important to know that we were in the process of revising this public expression committee. We've been in trying to do this for a while now. I think it's also important to note that the board does not have to allow any public comment. It's not a requirement. It's a privilege that the board offers the community and the other members to speak to us. Our job, as Mr. Sherlock pointed out, is we do the business of the board and school and what needs to be done. So, you know, this is a privilege, and this is the policy that we are looking at adopting. Just a minor change.
All right.
This is substantially the same policy, right? What are the differences? I guess I didn't catch them.
Mainly,
here it is.
When we went in and started discussing this in operations, I think the intent was actually to try to lessen the restrictions on public comment, at least when I brought it up initially. That didn't go over as well in the operations meetings to lessen the restraints. So rather than making it less limited, we cleared up the language, because when I wanted to request to be on public comment last year, I found the language to be confusing. You know, there was wording in there like, preferably you may request. To me, that means you don't have to. You could just show up here and start talking. And that wasn't the way we had operated. We wouldn't do that, you know, if somebody just showed up. So to me, when I asked that we start looking into the policy, it was more to make it more clear that, no, you can't just show up. You know, my intent was to make it so you could just show up, but that was vetoed. So that's where we ended up with just clearing up.
And making they're it, probably super mad, Ms. Kelly, that you actually brought that up. Right,
there's
now
not as much wishy-washy language, if you will, in it.
What my only concern is, what about that time frame? I mean, like the Wednesday before the next meeting, that's a lot of time. If we can't comment on what they are saying, what's the point in having that much time?
Well, we, the president and the vice president meet on Wednesday afternoon to go over the agenda for Tuesday's board meeting. And
okay.
It's it out on Friday. So it's when we sit down to go over what we're gonna, you know, what this is gonna look like, because there's a lot of work that goes into these board meetings and all the preparation that's done. So by noon on Wednesday, I mean, that's not to say that we won't allow
it, like it's for publishing.
But at least it gives us an idea of what are we looking at as far as public comment. And, you know, it gives us an opportunity to, you know, see what it looks like. We're going to have to extend it, or, you know, what do we need to do and prepare? Because if you're a board member and you've been elected, you want to prepare for the board meeting so that you know what's happening. So
okay.
By Wednesday at noon, then
it still
then
sounds like a bullshit cop out.
Vice president meets
essentially, they restricted your rights to, or your ability for your public comment. So congratulations, all you Looney Tunes, for ruining it for real parents that may be concerned, because you guys have bullshit points of view. And then, so we're just going to try to wrap this up real quick, because that's mostly the meat and potatoes. So that's a discussion item, so it's not being voted on tonight anyways, or this night. 1 hour and 39 minutes, they talk about a district website presentation, and Mike Martell and Dave Lasky, I always like Dave. Dave taught our computer class when I was in high school after I'd moved to the district, and he presents things that have changed the website. He gives a presentation for it, and then essentially informational items. They talk about meetings, and then they go into number 10, which is executive sessions. And then they give you a big list of why they can go into executive session and what the purpose of it is. and so moved. And then apparently after that, they do an adjournment. And that is always a big deal to me because, like, went through Common Council, I was required to turn my camera back on and show the adjournment of the meeting after the executive session, because otherwise my public record was not complete, and then they would essentially were violating open meetings law unless I presented them with, like, affidavits of what actually happened after the thing. It was a whole big hullabaloo, and these guys don't have to follow those rules, which is funny that their rules are a lot stricter than the Common Council's, but they don't follow certain open meeting law rules, which is kind of humorous to me. That's my own little 2 cents. So, well, we've taken you down a long enough rabbit hole, an hour and 20 minutes here, going over their meeting, which is almost an hour and 45. So, thanks guys for jumping in and, listening to this with us. And we will see you guys on the next one. Going to have a couple book reviews and, maybe today. And, I got to check with the Bagmans and see how they're making out back home and see if they got to those. Otherwise, we'll have to make time for them in the studio for the Common Council meetings. I believe there's 3 of those to catch up on. And I have one more school board meeting to catch up on from this past Tuesday, which I know the Bagmans have a couple to do too. So I'll hopefully listen to that, make notes, and get back to you guys. And we'll see you guys on the next time here on News Over Beers. And don't forget to see our favorite Uncle Tony. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Thank you.